Hello and welcome. This is the course on Ancient Indian History presented to you by Plus Pramesh e-Library. And here you can read about the mentor for this course, who is Supriya Singhal, which is me. And here is something more about me. And you can also follow me on my food blog as by the name of Crispy Stories. So now let's begin with the Unit 3. We've already covered two units in which we started from the prehistoric time. Okay. Then we went to the prehistoric is that time where we had Paleolithic, Mesolithic and Neolithic. Then we went to Harappan civilization. Then we discussed about the Vedic age. Then we also discussed about the Mahajanapadas. Then we also discussed about the rise of Buddhism and Jainism. And then we went on to discuss about basically in Magadha's only a continuation of something called as Magad. And in here we discussed about few dynasties. Like there was Haryanka dynasty, there was Sesungas. There was Nandas and there was Mauryas. And now we will study basically the post-Mauryan age. Like what happens after Mauryas? Like once the last ruler of Maurya that we discussed last time, okay, he is not there. Then what happens to the empire that they had? Does it get disintegrated or there is another dynasty taking over them? Okay. So let's start with the lesson number 7, which talks about the post-Mauryan India. So what happened was, see, we know that the Mauryan dynasty was established, it was established and it was a very powerful dynasty, okay, wherein rulers like Chandragupta Maurya, who was the founder, till Ashoka, we know that who was the one which unified India. So rulers like these existed in the Mauryan times. But we also know that, you know, there was a division of the empire after Ashoka, and we also know that it was divided into east and west, and finally there was like invasions that started happening. So what was happening was basically after the death of Ashoka, his successors were not able to control such vast empire, okay, and that is why you will realize that these small little provinces, they started declaring their independence. The Northwest India, it slipped out of the control of the Mauryan Empire because already I told you there were foreign invasions happening to that region. Kalinga, which was like the east, it declared the independence, and in the further south also you will find there is another dynasty taking place which is called as the Satavahan dynasty. And Satavahan dynasty, UPSC prelims has asked I think 2 or 3 times question on it, because this dynasty has not been covered extensively in NCRT, and lot of information about this dynasty is available in this Tamil Nadu book. So I actually request you to pay your complete attention so that you don't have to go through Satavahans again. Okay, but you will realize that the post-Mauryan time or the Mauryan Empire rule, like after the death of Ashoka, it was confined to only Gangetic Valley, because Kalinga has slipped out, Northwest India has slipped out, and this particular region, South India, has slipped out under Satavahans. But now we know that the last Mauryan ruler was killed by Pushyamitra Sunga, and that came the starting point of Sunga dynasty or Sunga rule. Okay, so the after Mauryas, in the Gangetic Valley, you can find Sungars are taking over. So the founder of Sunga dynasty was Pushyamitra Sunga, and he was actually, I told you, a general, a commander in chief in the army of Mauryas. He assassinated the last Mauryan ruler and then usurped the throne. The most important challenges to the Sunga rule was basically to protect this North Indian Empire, whatever they have got after defeating Mauryas, how to protect it from the invasions happening from all these sides. Okay, Gangetic Valley is like in the middle. You have Northwest also, you have East also, and you have South also. But the most important, the threat that they had was from the Northwest, because Bactrians, Greek, Huns, etc., you will realize they had started now coming into India. The Greeks advanced up to Pataliputra and they occupied it for some time. However, Pushyamitra succeeded and regained his lost territory, and he also fought a campaign against the Kharavela of Kalinga. So you already know that Kharavela of Kalinga also has something called as Hanti Gumpha caves, and these caves also had inscriptions which told you about the Mauryan Empire. Okay. Pushyamitra was a strong follower of Brahmanism. Unlike Ashoka, wherein we saw the rule of Dhamma, we saw the rise of Buddhism, because Ashoka also sent his son and daughter to spread around Buddhism in Sri Lanka. Now we are seeing basically a cultural change, religion change. Okay, Pushyamitra Sunga, who's establishing and the founder of Sunga dynasty, he is now a staunch follower of Hinduism, and Hinduism also Brahmanism. Okay, he performed 2 Ashwamedha sacrifices. And Buddhist sources also refer him to, as a persecutor of Buddhist people, like someone who has a hatred for Buddhist people, and he used to persecute them. ओके बट देर इज ऑल्सो इनफ एविडेंस टू शो दैट ही वॉज समवेयर हैड अ वेरी यू कैन से इंक्लिनेशन अ सॉफ्ट कॉर्नर फॉर बुद्धिस्ट आर्ट एंड दैट इज वाई यू कैन से दैट ही पैटर्नाइज बुद्धिस्ट आर्ट सो यू कैनॉट से कम्प्लीटली दैट ही वॉज एक्चुअली अ हेटर ऑफ बुद्धिस्ट पीपल एंड यूज टू परसिक्यूट दैम बिकॉज समवेयर यू हर फाउंड एविडेंस इज ऑल्सो ऑफ ही पैटर्नाइजिंग द बुद्धिस्ट आर्ट ओके एंड ड्यूरिंग हिस रेन एक्चुअली यू दे वर लाइक मॉन्यूमेंट्स एट भारत एंड सांची दैट गॉट रेनोवेटेड एंड इम्प्रूव्ड एंड दैट इज वाई यू आर कन्फ्यूज एज टू Pushyamitra wanted what? Does he wanted to like save Buddhism or did he want to actually persecute Buddhist? Okay, after the death of Pushyamitra, his son Agnimitra took over. But one piece of information you should know is that Pushyamitra was actually contemporary of Patanjali. Yes, he is the same Patanjali who is the founder of yoga philosophy. Okay, so after the death of Pushyamitra, his son Agnimitra became the ruler. The last Sunga ruler was Devabhuti, who was again murdered by his own minister, Vasudev Kanva. So basically, Mauryan last ruler got murdered by his general, Pushyamitra Sunga. And Pushyamitra Sunga established Sunga dynasty, whose last ruler got assassinated by their minister called as Vasudev Kanva. And he established basically the Kanva dynasty. Okay, so the Kanva dynasty was there for a very, very short period of time, around 45 years. And after the fall of Kanvas, you will realize that there was no dynasty which filled the gap and there was a huge gap until finally Gupta Empire started. So Guptas came later on, but you will find there was a good 100 to 200 years gap in between. There was a blank. Okay, there was like there's no nothing that you can fill in that blank. Now the rule of Sungas was important because they defended the Gangetic Valley from the foreign invasions. Okay, and in the cultural sphere also you will realize that they revived Brahmanism. And Brahmanism, as you already know, was dying. Why? Because Buddhism and Jainism simplified the practices. They gave people the simple way to actually, you know, achieve spirituality, achieve what they wanted to, called as Kevalya Gyan or Nirvana. So, and Brahmanism, we know it had a lot of corrupt practices, it was becoming very expensive, and that is why you will find that Sungas actually, you know, mark a shift in the history because they reversed this trend of rising Buddhism and, you know, made it as a trend of rising Brahmanism. Okay, they also promoted the growth of Vaishnavism and Sanskrit language, while we know that Buddha used to preach in Pali. So therefore you realize that, you know, there is a complete like reversal happening. Earlier when you were doing Sanskrit, then came Buddhism and Jainism, which started using these regional languages like Pali, Prakrit, etc., which are basically the languages of common people. But after that, again, now you have fallen back to Sanskrit. Okay, in short, you can say the Sunga ruler was a brilliant anticipation of what we call as the golden age of Guptas. Now, this was happening in the Gangetic Valley, where Mauryans, like you can say, Mauryans had a very strong foothold, and then Mauryans are out, and then Sungas are in, and then Sungas are out, and then Kanvas are in. But you already know that the South India has declared itself independent from the Mauryan, and there is another dynasty that has taken place, which is Satvahans. So, in the Deccan, you will find that the Satvahans have established their independent rule. So, either they are called as Satvahans or they can also be called as Satvahanas. Okay, so pronunciation can be different, but meaning is same. Basically, they are talking about one dynasty only. Their rule lasted for about 450 years. Like, it was a very stable rule. They were also known as Andhras, and this was asked in the prelims examination. The Purans and the inscriptions, they remain important sources of history of Satvahans. And this is very, very important. Because what was happening, you have a fairly evident, written evidence around this time to tell you that there was a dynasty called as Satvahanas. Okay. Among the inscriptions, the most important inscription is this Nasik inscription and also this Nandghad inscription, which show the light of one ruler who was also called as Gautamiputra Satkarni. So in Satvahanas, the society was not matriarchal. It was patriarchal, but the kings or the rulers were known by their mother's name. Okay, so if there's a question in an exam telling you that, you know, Satvahan dynasty is matriarchal, answer is wrong. It was patriarchal dynasty, but the rulers had their names after their mothers. Therefore, Gautamiputra Satkarni. Okay, the coins issued by Satvahanas were, you know, also threw light about the society, about the economics of that particular time. The founder of Satvahan dynasty, you should know, was Simuka. And then Simuka was succeeded by Krishna. Okay, and Krishna was the one who extended the empire up to Nashik in the west. So Nashik, you already know, basically lies where? Nashik is the place of Sai Baba. Correct. Okay, so it lies on the western side, like in basically in Maharashtra region. So the third king. So first was Simuka, who was the founder. Second was Krishna. Third was Sri Satakarni. And he was the one who conquered the western Berar and the Malwa region, like somewhere around here. Okay. And then he also performed Ashwamedha sacrifices, something that's telling you that they also used to follow Brahmanism. Okay. And finally, the 17th king of the Satavahan dynasty was Hala. And this Hala is very famous because he wrote a book. Okay. Hala is which ruler? 17th ruler. And how come you have 17 rulers? Because it's a good 450 years of rule. Okay, he actually reigned for a period of only 5 years, and Hala became famous, as I told you, for his book named Gat Sapt Sati. Okay, repeat with me, Gat Sapt Sati, and it is also called as Satsai. So basically, it's Hala Satsai. So you will never forget it, Hala Satsai, Hala Satsai. So Satsai is the book written by Hala, and it contains 700 verses, but in what language? Prakrit. So it's telling you that again, there is a reversal. What? That you were, they were Sanskrit, and now again there is Prakrit. Okay. The greatest ruler of Satavahan dynasty was his Gautamiputra Satkarni, of whose inscription we have found in Nashik. He ruled for a period of 24 years, from 106 to 130 AD. His achievements were recorded in Nashik inscription by his mother, Gautami Balsri. Okay, so Gautamiputra Satkarni, in the sense that Satkarni is the name of the person, and he is whose putra or whose son? Gautami's. So therefore, mother's name will be Gautami Balsri. Gautami Putra Satkarni, he captured the whole of Deccan area and he expanded the empire. His victory over, got a victory over Malwa and this Nagpana, etc. He patronized Brahmanism, as we already know that, you know, one of the rulers also did Ashwamedha practice here. But yet, you will realize that Gautami Putra Satkarni was not a hater of Buddhist. He used to patronize Buddhism also. And more than that, Ajanta paintings, if you have heard about them, they were actually during the Satavahan's time. So that it, and Ajanta paintings, we already know that they are completely or purely Buddhist in nature. Gautami Putra Satkarni was succeeded by his son Vashishth Putra Pulamai. Okay, he extended again the Satavahana's power up to the mouth of Krishna River. So now you're going further south, and he issued coins on which image of ships are there. But see, you can only make an image of something if you have already seen that thing. That means it tells you that the Satavahan dynasty was a naval power. They had maritime trade, maritime contacts outside of like the Satavahans and outside of India also. And the last great ruler of Satavahans was this Yajnashri Satakarni. Okay? So the two rulers that you should remember, three rulers that you should remember, founder Simuka, then 17th ruler Hala, and Gautamiputra Satakarni. Now we will look at the economic condition during the Satavahans. So there was a remarkable progress in the fields of trade, because you already know that there was maritime trade as well. There was a remarkable improvement in industry. The merchants organized guilds. Guilds in the sense, smaller groups to increase their activities. The craft guilds, craft guilds organized by different craftsmen, such as potters, there will be weavers, there will be oil pressers. So basically what's happening, you are specializing. You are saying that this is a group of people who has formed one guild, and this guild will perform only one work. Like these are the people who will be potters, these are the people who will be weavers, etc. Okay, so such guild system came into existence. Silver coins called Karshapanas. Now before we proceed, you need to tell me, we studied about Krishnala coins, right? So where did we study Krishnala coins, and are they silver or gold coins? Please write in the comment box. So you will realize the silver coins called Karshapanas were used for trade. The Satavahan period also witnessed some overseas commercial activity. Ptolemy person is basically a writer. He's the one who has written many great books. Okay. So he also mentions about these ports of Deccan. That means that he knew about ports of Deccan. And if he knew, that means there was a trade existing between Satavahan and the place where he used to live. Okay. The greatest port of Satavahan was Kalyani. And this is how you remember. See, Ganjam is a district even today. Okay. And we know that it is in Odisha. So Ganjam is Odisha or Andhra Pradesh? Actually, you need to tell me that. Okay, so let me pose you a question. Where is Ganjam? Okay, as a district today. But in that time, you will realize there was basically Ganjam and Kalyani. They were the two port cities of this Satavahan dynasty. So Kalyani was on the western side and Ganjam was on the eastern side. Okay, and they were important seaports. Now we will talk about the cultural contribution. Satavahans patronized the Buddhism and Brahmanism. Okay. And we know that they were followers of Brahmanism, but they used to also, you know, patronize Buddhists, because they used to patronize their artwork. Okay, they also built chaityas and viharas for the Buddhist monks. They also made grants of villages so that Buddhist monks could survive, because they used to survive on alms given by people. And that is why if you basically grant a particular village to them, that means all the village people will take care of those Buddhist monks. Vashishth Putra Pulamai, he repaired this old Amravati stupa. So if you know, if you have studied about the sculpture making, okay, of which I have told about in another course, which is Ancient History Wall Chart. Okay, I've told you that there were three kinds of sculpture making, which was Gandhara, Mathura, and then Amravati. So this Amravati style actually developed under Satvahans. Okay, Brahmanism was also revived by Satvahans along with the performance of Ashwamedha sacrifices and Rajasuya, basically the conspiration ceremonies. They also patronized the Prakrit language, as I told you, and literature, because Hara Satsai is an important piece of Prakrit literature. Now, see, we know that in Gangetic Valley, there was replacement of Mauryas by Sungas and Sungas by Kanvas. In Deccan, there is basically emergence of Satvahanas. But what is happening in the Northwest India? So, Northwest India is actually this time facing foreign invasions. So, there are four different, you can say, foreign invaders you will study about, which will be Bactrians, Parthians, Scythians and Kushans. Okay, or Scythians or Sakas. So, these are the four people we'll be studying about, and you should listen to it carefully. So, Bactrians, you will realize, just a minute, Syria and Parthia, they became independent from the Syrian Empire. So, now we have moved to Syria. Okay, same Syria where we know that there is today international crisis going on. There is so much of bombings, etc. going on. This was the place where ISIS also developed. Okay, so you will realize that Bactria and Parthia, they were actually part of Syria, but then they became independent in the mid of 3rd century BC. Demetrius, who was the Greek ruler of Bactria then, he invaded Afghanistan and Punjab and he occupied them from Taxila. He sent two of his commanders, Apollodotus and Menander, okay, for further conquest. And this Menander guy is very, very famous. Why? We will read it just after this. Apollodotus conquered the Sindh and he marched up to Ujjain. Okay, he's further moving inside India. While Menander, he extended his rule up to Mathura. And he also made attempts to capture Pataliputra. But he was stopped by the army of Vasumitra, who was the grandson of Pushyamitra Sunga. So Pushyamitra Sunga, then there was Agnimitra Sunga, and then there is Vasumitra Sunga. Okay, so Vasumitra was the one who's actually, you know, holding, who's actually not allowing these Bactrians to enter. Then there is Menander. Menander is actually known as Milinda, and he made his capital, like the kingdom that he had, he made his capital as Sialkot, which is basically Sakala. And this particular piece of information is very, very important because this has been asked, I think, in so many of these state service examinations also. So this Menander is also known as Milinda, and the capital of his kingdom is at Sakala or Sialkot. He basically had much interest in Buddhism and the dialogues, okay, with a Buddhist monk called Nagasena. So this Menander guy accidentally had a dialogue with Nagasena, okay, and their dialogues got compiled in a book which is written in Pali, and that book's name is Milinda Pahano, okay, basically the questions of Milinda or questions of Menander. And after these questions, or after these 12 questions with Nagasena, who was a Buddhist monk, basically Menander changed his religion and he started embracing Buddhism. So that is why this particular book is important, because somebody was able to change someone's religion just by conversation. Okay, a Greek ambassador, Heliodorus, he became a Vaishnavite and erected a Garud pillar. So this is another piece of information wherein another person, basically a Greek person, Heliodorus, he is becoming a Vaishnavite and he now is erecting a Garud pillar. And Garud, you know, is a Vahan of Vishnu. Okay, and he is erecting pillar at Besnagar. The Greek influence in India, it lasted for more than like 100 years after the death of Milinda or Menander. Now we have another, foreign invasion happening via Sakas. So Sakas, also known as Scythians, they attacked Bactria and Parthia, and now they captured basically them from the Greek rulers. And following the footsteps of the Greeks, Sakas also eventually extended their empire to reach Northwest India. And there were two different Sakas or Satraps. Basically, one was the Northern Satraps, okay, which was ruling this Taxila region. So if I have to draw India, like if here is Jammu and Kashmir, so somewhere here is Taxila. So this is like the Northern Satrap. And then there is Western Satrap, which is ruling over Maharashtra region, like Gujarat Maharashtra region. The founder of Saka rule in India in the 1st century BC was Mayus, and his son and successor was Aziz I, who was considered to be the founder of Vikram era. And Saka rulers of Taxila were overthrown by Parthians. Now, we will study about the third foreign invader, which is Kushanas. So the Kushans were the branch of Yuchi tribe, okay, whose original home was Central Asia. The same Central Asia which today has 5 countries, okay, which is Kyrgyzstan, Kazakhstan, Turkmenistan, Tajikistan and Uzbekistan. They first came to Bactria, displacing the Sakas, and then they gradually moved to the Kabul Valley, and then they seized this Gandhara region. Okay, the founder of Kushan dynasty was Kujula Kadafis, and he was also called as the Kadafis's one. He occupied this Kabul Valley and he issued the coins in his name. His son Vima Kadafis or Kadafis II also conquered the Northwest India as far as, and he extended his empire till Mathura. He issued the gold coins with high sounding names like Lord of the whole world, and he was an ardent devotee of Lord Shiva. Okay, and one of these Kushan rulers is Kanishka, and since he is famous, he has done a lot of work, so we will be studying about him in detail. So Kanishka is basically present around 78 AD, and he was the most important ruler of Kushan dynasty. He was the founder of Saka era, which starts from 78 AD, and he was not only a great conqueror but also a great patron of religion and art. Kanishka's conquest. At the time of accession of his empire, basically you will realize this Gandhara region, Afghanistan, Sindh, they were already the part of Kushan's empire. Subsequently, Kanishka actually entered India and he conquered Magad. He extended as far as Pataliputra and Bodh Gaya, okay, and went in north till Kashmir. And he also basically will find that in south also he has gone like little down. Okay, so that means what is happening? His empire is extended in the east also, in the north also, a little bit south also. Okay, and he conquered a greater part of this Gangetic Valley. He also fought against the Chinese and acquired some territories from them also. During the first expedition, he was defeated by this Chinese general Pancho, and then he undertook a second expedition wherein he was the victor. He achieved the victory, and finally you will realize that Kanishka is one ruler who is not just he was not just a lover of art, but he believes in expanding the empire. So what is happening? He has gotten some territory from his grandfathers and all, but now he's expanding his empire. So this territory was only like outside today's India in the northwestern region. Now he's extended it till Mathura, then he has gone till the east, then he has gone till North Kashmir, and then he has also acquired some territories from the Chinese. Okay, and now you will realize that he has also gone far northwest to acquire some more territories. So that's why we can say that empire of Kanishka was one which was extending from Gandhara in the west, okay, till Banaras in the east, then Kashmir in the north to Malwa in the south. So this is the extent of Kanishka's empire, which you should know. His capital was Purushapura or modern day Peshawar. Okay, Peshawar is in Pakistan today. And see, Peshawar is little, his empire is big, right? So he cannot have just one capital situated here. So the other alternative capital, which was also the cultural city and important city that time, which became his second capital or something, which was basically Mathura. Okay, now we will see about Kanishka and his relation to Buddhism. So Kanishka embraced Buddhism in the early part of his life. Okay, however, his coins exhibit that he was not just embracing Buddhism but also other gods, be it Hindu or Greek. It reflects that Kanishka was, see, whatever your ideology be, you are not enforcing it on people. You are saying, this is my ideology, I'll follow it, but you are free to choose whatever you want. And that is why this tolerance is shown in his coins, wherein Hindu gods, Greek gods, and even Buddha find its place. Okay, in the age of Kanishka, the Mahayana Buddhism actually got established, and it firmly got established. And this is the time when fourth Buddhist council is taking place. And finally, there's a division of Buddhism into Mahayana and Hinayana. Mahayana is called as the upper wheel, and Hinayana is called as the lower wheel. And finally, you will realize that Kanishka ends up following Mahayana Buddhism. Okay, and this Mahayana Buddhism is different from Hinayana Buddhism, and Hinayana Buddhism is the one which Ashoka is following, is the one which Buddha actually preached and Buddha started. But some changes happened, and then you will find there is another sect called as the Mahayana Buddhism. So you will be finding that, you know, whatever Buddha resisted, that he should not be worshipped as idol, or he should not be worshipped with flowers and expensive gifts. Okay, so you should always use language like Pali and Prakrit, which people can understand. So all the things that he said not to do are being done by the Mahayana Buddhism followers. Okay, so Buddha now came to be worshipped as an idol with flowers, garments, perfumes, and lamps, and thus image worship and rituals, like expensive rituals, also came along with the. Kanishka also sent missionaries to Central Asia and China for the propagation of new faith. Just like Ashoka was sending missionaries to whom? He was sending missionaries to Sri Lanka to spread Buddhism. You will realize even Kanishka is sending missionaries to Central Asia and China. Buddhist chaityas and viharas are also getting constructed in different places. And he is patronizing Buddhist scholars like Vasumitra, Ashwaghosha, and Nagarjun. Okay, he also convened the fourth Buddhist council that I told you, wherein matters relating to Buddhist theology got discussed. And it was held at where? It was held in Kashmir, basically. in a place called Kundalwan, okay, near Srinagar. And here you will realize, I told you there was a president and there was a vice president. President was Vasumitra and vice president was Ashwaghosha. Okay, about 500 monks attended this council and the council prepared an authoritative work on Tripitakas, and finally Mahayana doctrine got its final shape. Ashwaghosha was also a great philosopher, poet and dramatist, and he was the author of Buddha Charita. This you need to know because this has been asked in many civil state services examination. Okay, who is the author of Buddha Charita? Written by Ashwaghosha. Nagarjuna was basically from South India and he also was present in the court of Kanishka. He was the famous physician. Okay, so there were two famous physicians which were present during the Kanishka's time. Who were those? Charak and Sushrut. So you need to tell me one thing. Is Sushrut the one adorning the Kanishka's court or not? Because see, there have been only three great physicians. Two of them were present in Kanishka's court. Okay, now we will discuss about the art form, which is also called as the Gandhara art, that existed during the time of Kanishka or Kushanas. Okay, so you will realize that the Gandhara school of art, which is also the sculpture, one of the schools of sculpture making, is the territory in and around Peshawar, basically this region, and in the northwestern side. The best of Gandhara sculpture was produced during this time of Kushanas. Okay, and it had an element of Indo-Greek style, and this question was asked in the UPSC mains examination 2019, which is basically the recent one. Okay, and the real patrons of this art form were Kushanas and particularly Kanishka. Gandhara art, as I already told you, was a blend of Indian elements. Okay, and specimens of Gandhara sculpture, they have been found in Taxila, Peshawar and also in some parts of Northwest India. Gandhara school, I already told you, since Kanishka is following Mahayana Buddhism, so you will find now Buddha has a proper face, proper image and a proper sculpture. So now in Gandhara art, you will find Buddha in the form of sculptures, okay? And in various sizes, in various shapes, in various postures. And the reliefs depict Buddha's birth, his renunciation, him preaching or him showing other people the way. Okay, now we will study some salient features which make a particular sculpture look like it is a Gandhara art form. So if you look at a sculpture of Buddha, you can easily identify whether it is Gandhara or whether it is Mathura region. Okay, so Gandhara region sculptures had this few elements. For example, you will find there was like the Buddha's body was basically very detailed. It has physical features like this mustache. There's a beard also. Like Buddha is having muscles and there is like a lot of curly and wavy hair. Okay. There is a thick drapery of cloth. Okay. And there are like folded lines. Those creases are there. Folded lines are there on the cloth that Buddha is wearing. There's a rich carving. There is enormous ornamentation like he's wearing like those rings, etc. And there is symbolic expression. And the main theme of whole of this idea was basically Mahayana Buddhism. Okay, the larger number of monasteries were also built. And here you will find the monasteries are getting bigger and bigger in size. Even you will realize the original or the old stupas and monasteries that were built are also becoming bigger in size. Like things are getting added on to them. And you will find that Buddhist stupas erected during this time, they had a Greco-Roman element in them. Okay, and here you will find that there is much more, like Buddha has been given much more ornamentation. He's not shown as a simple man, but someone who looks like a little bit different from a normal human being. Okay, and here stupas have also started getting those, Buddha sculptures. So earlier Buddha was not represented like an idol. Okay, he was represented by symbols like empty throne, like lotus, like horse, like wheel. But now what is happening? He's gotten a face. So now these sculptures, etc. will also be in which Buddha is shown. And these sculptures will now adorn the different stupas. Okay, and that is why you will find that stupas have become much more attractive. Now the second kind of art that existed during the Kushanas time only was Mathura school of art. And this, as the name suggests, developed in and around Mathura, which is in UP. Okay, and it also flourished during the Kushanas time and particularly Kanishka's time. But this art form, unlike Gandhara, did not have any foreign elements, did not have any Greek or Roman touch to it. It was purely very indigenous in nature. Unlike Gandhara art, which was only Buddhist, you will realize that Mathura art had Buddhism also, Jainism also and Hinduism also. Okay. Then here you will find the images of Shiva also, Vishnu and his 10 avatars, then Parvati and Lakshmi also. Okay, unlike Gandhara art where you were seeing that Buddha was You can say that somewhere Buddha was not very happy and you know he was like very lean and his muscles were shown, etc. Here Buddha is very actually full body and he is like very spiritual, he is very happy. So there is like a difference in the Buddha's images also. There is like a sad Buddha and there is like a happy Buddha. So happy Buddha is what I call is from Mathura, and little bit sad is Buddha is basically what I call is from Gandhara art. So I'm not saying like I'm not hurting anybody's feelings here. If I'm not saying sad and happy Buddha, I'm just telling you so that you can remember it in your head. Happy and sad Buddha basically goes to this Peshawar region and then happy Buddha goes to this Mathura region. Okay, and here you will also find the female figurines like Yakshinis and Apsaras, which are present frequently in this Mathura school of art. Now finally, what happens after Kanishka? So who are the successors of Kanishka and what happens after the end of Kushan rule? The successors of Kanishka, you will find, so they ruled for pretty good amount, like 100 to 150 years. And Huvishka was the son of Kanishka and he kept the empire intact. Okay, Mathura became an important city because it was already an alternate capital. Like Kanishka, he was also a patron of Buddhism. But the last important Kushan ruler was Vasudeva. And the Kushan empire, this Vasudeva is not the same as Vasudeva Kanva, okay, don't get confused. And the Kushan empire was very much reduced in his rule. Because what is happening? See, there is a great ruler, so there is a great empire. But as soon as that ruler dies, that great ruler dies, his successors are not able to maintain the empire's sanctity. And that is why this empire becomes shorter, because other people start declaring their independence. So during Kanishka and probably his son Huvishka's time, the empire is intact. But as soon as these people get replaced by their successors, they are weak. And that is why their empire gets shorter and shorter. Okay, and the last ruler, you will also find that he is significantly like different from his ancestors because he has started in worshipping Shiva, basically Hinduism. Okay, and after Vasudeva also, you will find some here and there, two, three princes of Kushan still rule the northwestern India. But still, you can say mainly the Kushan empire has come to an end. Okay.